Good evening, folks. Welcome to the October 20th meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. We'll start off this evening with a review of the minutes of last month's meeting. Do we have any addendum or changes or...
Madam Chair, the only thing I had was on page 2, about halfway down. William Simons should be identified as Mr. William Simons. Other than that, I thought things were fine.
I move that they're accepted with that one correction.
Second the motion.
So moved. All in favor? Raise your right hand. We have a number of items of correspondence tonight. First, we have a letter to the Coldfield Association from Michael McGovern on Subdivision Roads. We have a letter from Michael McGovern from Maureen, Michael McGovern to Maureen O'Meara with regard to Rams Head Subdivision.
Madam Chair, could I make a comment on these two letters if I could?
Yes, you may.
I'd like to emphasize that the first letter from Michael McGovern had to do with the status of road classifications. It was addressed to Coldfield Association, indicating that the Coldfield Association apparently would be interested in having the town take over some of the roads in that subdivision. And Mr. McGovern is recommending that someone from the association monitor what the planning board is considering in the way of reclassification of road standards right now, and that the association should move forward only if it desires after the new standards are in place. I guess I'd like to issue a notification to the public that we are considering road standards, and if anybody has an interest, they better keep an eye out for what's going on. With respect to the second letter from Mr. McGovern, Madam Chair, with your permission, I'd like to, it's relatively short, I'd like to read it into the record because it has to do with Mr. McGovern's comments on a recent something that happened in the planning board.
I welcome you're doing it. Please.
With your permission, this is dated September the 21st. Addressed to Maureen O'Meara. Dear Maureen, over this past weekend, I watched a portion of the cable rerun of a recent planning board meeting in which Rams Head was discussed. Watching the meeting, I was deeply disturbed by comments made by Mr. Cheney and Mr. Hare, which misrepresented conversations we had had with them. Mr. Cheney also referenced a memorandum I had sent to you and intimated that within the memorandum I took a certain position, which I had not taken. I was portrayed as some sort of land grabber when in the memorandum I actually only pointed out provisions of our ordinance and inquired as to how the board was dealing with them. Never did I publicly or privately, either verbally or in writing, demand public access to a beach owned by the applicant. Please let the planning board know that this simply did not occur. A more significant concern I have after watching the meeting's videotape is the status of the alternative exit the applicant proposes in order to comply with the dead-end road standard. The applicant's counsel presents a present dirt road as the alternative access, but hedges on giving any assurances as to the future condition of the road or whether or not it could support the weight and width of emergency equipment. I'm also left unclear as to what rights the owners of the proposed subdivision or the town would have if the road was not maintained or if it was abandoned. Several years ago, I did a study of how Broad Cove came to be built with only one means of egress. In the late 1960s, the planning board was given assurances that a dirt road at Farm Pond Road was going to be improved to become passable. This never occurred. I have a strong sense of deja vu as I listened to the discussion on Ram's Head. I believe it would be in the best interest of all the major property owners in the Sprague land to develop a master plan on how egress is to be provided over the long term. Otherwise, everyone in the future is going to run into the same issues that Shaw Sprague now faces. If there is no interest in the landowners in resolving the issue among themselves, I urge the planning board to be especially careful in reviewing the status of the alternative egress road being proposed at this time. I look forward to discussing with you my concerns cited in this letter upon my return from vacation. Sincerely yours.
Thank you, Janet. The next item we have is a letter from the Cumberland County Soil and Waste, Soil and Water Conservation District to Peter Kennedy. And at this point, I'm going to put this aside and bring it up again a little bit later. We have an Environmental and Development, September of 1992 newsletter, Travel and Demand Management newsletter, Historic Survey Report.
Could I just make a comment? It seems to be my night for comments, Madam Chair. On the survey report, I'd like to say that this is a reconnaissance-level survey done by Greater Portland Landmarks in the form of Ann Ball, who was here in Cape Elizabeth for a number of times. She submitted it on August the 28th, 1992. And it is just an initial survey, but attached is a street index of properties that are more than 50 years old. And Maureen, I don't know whether the survey consists of any more than what the document is that we have in our hands at this point. Could you help me out on that?
In doing the survey, what she did is take a picture and fill out a landmarks, actually it's a Maine Historic Preservation Survey form for every structure in Cape Elizabeth, which she believed to be at least 50 years old and have some integrity to the original historic character of the building. I have a copy of all of those photos and survey forms in the planning office, and people can certainly come in and take a look at those and get at least a baseline amount of information on different structures in the town.
Good, thank you.
Okay, the next item we have is a letter from Ernest McVane, race and violations at the Highlands at Broad Cove. We have two letters here tonight before us, or we received this month, relative to the Highlands at Broad Cove, and I would like to read them into the record if you don't mind. The first is from the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District, and the subject is Highlands at Broad Cove. This is from Ross Cudlitz, their district engineer, to Mr. Peter Kennedy. And I'm reading now. At the request of Linda Kochmuller, DEP Land Bureau, we visited the subject site to view the work being done on the emergency gravel access road. The following observations were made. The cleared and grubbed area beyond the hammerhead of Jordan Farm Road appears to be considerably wider than the DEP order called for. The order restricts activity to approximately 20 feet. The cleared area is approximately 35 feet wide and is wider in some locations. Silt fence is not completely installed for the length of this disturbance, and some of the stockpiles appear to be in wetland areas and not contained in others. Recognizing that nothing can be restored at this point, Linda and I have spoken and proposed the following fix. Silt fence needs to be completed on the southeasterly edge of the disturbance for the entire length, properly installed. In addition, another fence line needs to be established approximately 15 feet to the in towards the towards the gravel road from the first. This new line is the limit of construction as intended by the DEP order. The region between the two fences is to be seeded and mulched. The seed mix should be primarily winter rye. It is too early for dormant seeding of a perennial because the young root will die in the cold freeze. Next spring, you should reseed right over the mulch with a mix specified in the plans. Eventually, wetland vegetation will move back into the region on its own. Otherwise, the remainder of Phase 1 is stable and is in good condition. If you, the DEP, or the Town of Cape Elizabeth have any questions, please don't hesitate to contact our district office. That letter was dated September 23rd. We have an October 5th, 1992 letter to Peter Kennedy. This is from Ernest McVane, our code enforcement officer, and it's regarding wetland violations at the Highlands at Broad Cove. Dear Mr. Kennedy, I've been in contact with Leonard Kochmuller, Land Bureau, Department of Environmental Protection. My understanding is that you have violated conditions of your DEP permit, which governs the placement of the gravel access road. Due to deviations from the approved plans, a building permit will not be obtainable for any new construction on any lot that abuts the access road. I visited the site on September 29, 1992, and determined that you have violated several conditions of the subdivision approval and wetland regulations. Following is a summary of my findings. 1. Note C of the subdivision plans requires that buffers be maintained. The required buffer between the approved lots and the access road has been cleared. Note 5 on the subdivision plan states that cutting of trees within 15 feet of a lot line where two lots abut is prohibited. A comment is that the required 15-foot buffer between lots 4, 5, and 6 has been significantly reduced. Item 3, clear cutting of lots is prohibited. A comment is that you have not provided a site plan for work performed on lot 4. The above work was performed without proper erosion and sedimentation control. You've caused a direct violation of the conditions of the wetland alteration permit, a special permit granted to you by the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. In order to bring this project into compliance, a wetlands restoration and creation plan will be required, meeting the criteria found in sections 19.3.9.11 of the zoning ordinance. In accordance with section 19.3.9.13 of the zoning ordinance, I'm requiring the restoration plan to be submitted to me by October 30th, 1992. Plans shall be submitted by a professional qualified to prepare wetland mapping. If you have any questions or you should disagree with my findings, please call me or contact me.
Madam Chair, I'd like to ask the town planner if is there anything more current than these two letters with respect to the Highlands? Do we know what the status of the project is at this point?
I was out there this afternoon with the town manager and the code enforcement officer, and there's nothing else in writing at this time. I believe the code enforcement officer is waiting for the information he requested in his letter.
It disturbs me greatly that conditions that were very clearly specified by the planning board in the approval of this plan have not been and are not being complied with, and I wonder whether there is any mechanism for asking Mr. Kennedy to come and explain to the board why indeed he felt it necessary not to comply with the specific conditions that were set forth in the approval of the plan?
My understanding is that unless the applicant needs to come back to the board for something that requires review, this is basically an enforcement action and something that the board typically will not get involved in. The only thing that I can see the board doing is to make a recommendation of some kind, but you have no authority that I'm aware of to do anything in terms of enforcement.
What if an applicant simply did something that was highly outrageous? Would the code enforcement officer simply issue a stop work permit, and then the applicant would be forced to do something after that in order to continue with the project? Is that the way the mechanism works?
Yes, and there is some opportunity. In fact, the code enforcement officer, what he stated when he talks about violations that require a wetlands alteration permit, what he's stating is that if the applicant doesn't show due diligence in correcting the problem, the code enforcement officer will probably send him to the planning board for a wetlands alteration permit.
I suspect that Mr. Kennedy will not come before the planning board particularly willingly, so I will wait, but I certainly would like my comments on the record.
At this time, there are two portions of the site where the applicant, there is a stop work order, so there's no additional work that can be done out there, and if he wants to sell any lots and get any building permits, he's going to have to bring the site into compliance.
Thank you.
And Chair.
Mr.
Sorry.
Edsel.
I realize it's unusual to have discussion on correspondence, but
got some good letters tonight, though.
Quite a long list of them. In reference to the letter from Ernie McVane, I guess I'll go through the planner. Is there a reason why the stop work order was placed only on those lots which abut or use that road as an access road?
Good question.
Wasn't the plan itself, I'm trying to think back because it was an odd recording of the plat.
Good question.
And a slightly odd approval of the entire subdivision in stages and phases. Why would not the stop work order be implemented on all of the lots?
Because only parts of it are approved. We are only phasing on it.
But it does not come back for the planning board for future approval.
It does.
Okay.
It does. Yeah.
Well, I'm nodding a shake here.
I'd like to pursue this line of reasoning just a minute. Is it true that all of the lots that Mr. Kennedy is authorized to proceed with at the present time are subject to the stop work order?
Yes. In Phase 1A, where he's posted a guarantee, there are no outstanding violations, and I believe that he has sold all three of those lots, and the construction is continuing on the last of the open lots. He is then, when the board approved the project, there was discussion about either approving it in phases or approving the whole project, and the board chose to approve the whole project, and a plat was recorded showing all phases. However, there was concern that work may be begun or lots may be sold on phases where there was no performance guarantee, and new lot owners would expect roads to be built where the town would not be able to meet that expectation because we didn't have the performance guarantee. So there was a note added on the plan that requires that the developer may not sell any lots, may not start any construction in any phases where there has not been a performance guarantee posted and then an affidavit recorded by the town. As of this date, a performance guarantee has been posted for phases 1B and 2A. So an affidavit was recorded for those two phases. He's now received stop work orders for both those phases.
Thank you.
Next, we have a letter from Barbara McCusick and Paul Escord relative to the Cape Woods, a letter from Judith Sider relative to Cape Woods, Threshold to Maine Fall Newsletter, and a letter from Patricia Snow, Ray the Gramsys Wetlands Alteration Permit.
Madam Chair, I guess it's my turn again on the last letter, anyway, from Patricia Snow. I'd like to again state for the record that Ms. Snow was one of the applicants for this after-the-fact wetlands alteration permit. She's apparently writing to us to register her quote-unquote total dismay with the process that she's just been through. I'd like to state for the record that this particular member of the planning board, and I believe I'm joined by other members of the planning board, are seriously considering recommending a penalty provision to the town council, which includes the assessment of fines to be added to the wetlands regulations. The board is very particularly uncomfortable with after-the-fact wetlands alteration permit applications, where a permit may be ultimately issued without addressing the initial disregard of the ordinance requirements, which in the particular case we have just been through was, I would have to say, was magnificent. So I would like to state on the record that this continues to be a very serious problem for the board, and I hope that we will actually be able to take up this recommendation later tonight, this recommendation to the town council that penalty provisions be added.
Thank you, Ms. McKay. Actually, I'm probably, I don't know if I'm going to tip my hand on this, would like to have read into the record, and perhaps later on we might be appropriate, both the Snow letter and a wonderful response that Judy Lardner wrote, which is part of our information here tonight, at the time that we take on the wetlands enforcement recommendation to the town council. That's it in this first bit of information. The next piece of business is old business under Rams Head Subdivision. Before I go any further, I will advise the board that In by the Sea has been removed from tonight's agenda at the request of the applicant. It's not tabled, it's just not there, so we can draw a line right through that.
Madam Chair, is it not tabled because it hasn't actually come before us yet?
It hasn't become before us. It's like it never existed right now.
Okay.
I just don't want any clocks ticking. As with all the other Rams Head items, I'm going to recuse myself and let Janet McKay, however, I know it's going to be short, so we won't switch chairs.
I was going to say, this should be able to be handled easily. Acting chair for this particular item, Shaw Sprague is requesting that the board table his application for Rams Head, a four-lot subdivision located at the end of Charles E. Jordan Road. The applicant would like additional time to address the open space and dead-end road issues. As I understood from Rick Chenet's letter, he was recommending that the item be tabled until the regular November meeting of the board. So do I hear any discussion or motion?
Madam Chair.
Mr. Edsel?
I have a motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Shaw Sprague for minor subdivision review, wetlands alteration permit, and public access waivers for Ramsett, a four-lot subdivision located off Charles E. Jordan Road, be tabled to the regular November 1992 meeting of the planning board with consent of the applicant.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
I'm sorry, I forgot to appoint Judith Lardner as the as a voting member for this matter. Any discussion? All in favor? Thank you. The vote is 4-0 with Ms. Kane abstaining.
Thank you. Indeed, for the rest of the meeting, it looks, Judy, like we'll have to bring you on board for full duty tonight. I do appoint Judy Lardner, voting member, for the next items. I like it when we're running ahead. Our next item on the agenda tonight under new business, I know, is the Cape Woods subdivision amendments request by James Development Company for previously approved Cape Woods subdivision located at Mitchell and Cape Woods Road in accordance with Section 16-2-5 of the subdivision ordinance. Do we have someone from Cape Woods who will come up and tell us what we're up to here? Not us, because we already know, but we do have a viewing audience who's completely in the cold. Can you identify yourself?
Good evening, Madam Chairman, members of the board. My name is Dave Camilla, and I'm with Land Use Consultants in Portland, Maine. And I'm here on behalf of James Development Corporation, which is the current owners of the Cape Woods condominium project. As you probably know, this project started back around 1986, and the original developer was William DeBias. He built the first eight units, which represented on the plan I have here, are these darker units near the Mitchell Road. James Development picked up the project after it was taken back by the bank, and they're in the process currently of building the remainder of the roadway, and there's 14 additional units that have yet to be constructed. As they got into the construction, they realized that some of the proposed grades for the buildings seemed a little high in relationship to the existing ground contours, and that's when we were called in to take a look at the plan and propose some revised first floor elevations and grading, and that's the basic content of what we're here tonight for, is to request an approval of an amended grading plan, which you see here. Basically, what we have done in most cases is lowered first floor elevations anywhere from 3 feet to, in some cases, just 1 foot. There is one duplex which we actually raised the elevations to avoid some existing groundwater conditions. The basic thrust of this whole thing is in phase one. Because of the amounts of fill that were needed to build the units up to the grades proposed, a lot of the trees that were intended to be preserved were not saved. Some were left and filled around and they died, and additional ones were cleared that intended to be saved. So our proposal is to reduce those grades and reduce the amount of fill so that we can save more of the trees around the units. We have looked at the comments, and we have met with Maureen yesterday and gone over her proposed conditions of approval. And I guess, you know, if it's all right with the board, I'd like to go over some of those proposed conditions and give you some of our thoughts. You know, if you're so inclined. Basically, the first comment, which relates to the town engineer's review, Fred Morin, he's asking for some additional plans to be amended so that all the information that's shown on the grading plan, which also shows up consequently on some of the other plans, be added. And we have no problem with that. Obviously, we didn't submit those plans at the time we made this submission. And so what Maureen has proposed is a conditional approval tonight, and then we submit those plans for administrative approval after this meeting without coming back to the planning board. And we would very much like that to be the process from this point forward. We We'll go along with the tree preservation plan. Basically, I guess what the intent of that is to actually mark the trees in the field, in the areas where they're to be preserved, so there's some visual identification so that the code enforcement officer or whoever chooses can go out and see on the site where the actual trees are intended to be preserved, and the developer will prevent any heavy equipment or any, you know, machinery from going into that area and getting under the trees to damage the roots and preserve those trees. We would, though, reserve the right to go in those areas and do some clearing of underbrush, and we would like to put some bark mulch down in front of the units, not over the entire site, but just in the front yards, basically, of the units, so that they'll be a little more attractive and a little more, you know, usable by the unit owners. There's also a request to move one of the driveways, and we have no problem with that. As it was stated in the comments, it was referred to as units 7 and 8, and I believe that's intended to be units 5 and 6, which is the first new unit as you come into the project. This is not yet under construction. There, however, was a driveway that was started by the previous owner, and where it is located is actually approximately in that location, a little bit closer to Mitchell Road than the original design. It does avoid several trees, so we have no problem with continuing to use that driveway as it's already been started when we do build that unit. That will be shown on the plans that we will submit, you know, if you approve our request. The fourth comment the fourth condition was to do with continuing construction. The intent was to halt construction now until we make these additional corrections and revisions, and once they're approved, then start up again. And there's a problem in that there's a unit right now that's the foundation is completed. It's unit number 9 right here. The subcontractor to do the framing is ready to start any day, and not knowing how long this process might take, even a couple of weeks at this time of year, is a big problem for the contractor, and so we would like to continue at least on that one unit, and perhaps set an alternative as a deadline, perhaps the next planning board meeting, November 17th, as a deadline date for us to make all the revisions and get the plans in to the planner and the town code enforcement officer for review, and you know, subject to that being our deadline. Then if we didn't make that deadline, we would stop construction at that point in time. But this enables us to keep going and not stop at this time of year, and also continue with the process with the town. So basically, that's our comments as far as the proposal goes. Basically, I guess what I feel is that these are relatively minor changes that we're requesting, things that you might normally handle as construction changes, but understanding that this is an approved plan and these do affect the final plans, we will go along and you know, make the changes and go through the process. However, we would like not to have to keep coming back to planning board meetings, mm-hmm. you know, continually for a period of time and do this administratively. And I guess with that, I would you know, end my presentation and just open it up to questions from the board. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Do we have any comments from the board? We'll start off with that.
I'd like to find out what the mechanism, I know we don't absolutely have to have a public hearing, and maybe not one is required, but I don't know if anybody here this evening would be interested in speaking to the project. And I don't know, let me back up. How was this particular item on the agenda announced? Were abutting property owners notified, Maureen?
Yes, there were. Anytime there's a subdivision or a subdivision amendment, there are state requirements as well as the requirement that the town has that any new item on the planning board agenda has to be, you have to notify the abutters. I believe it's anyone within 500 feet.
I don't have any particular questions for the applicant, but I would be interested in hearing if there's a member of the public that would like to speak.
Mr. Etzel.
Madam Chair. Question of the planner. When I read through this, the first question that came up is it deals with the scope of our review in this situation and the fact that it's a condominium project and trying to stay consistent with our history of review of sites. I guess if you could explain to me, in this situation, how extensive is the scope of the review? Number two, is the current owner, has the current owner picked up declarant rights and responsibilities or liabilities? Four other sections of the completed project. I guess if you could get me started there, it would be a big help.
The first question on the extent of review, the ordinance, it says, Section 16.25, says that basically any time you make any change to a subdivision plan, you have to go back to the planning board and get approval. And that also requires any change should require the applicant to submit a recording plat. Other than that, it doesn't give the board a lot of guidance. My advice would be that any time a project comes back to you, that you can look at any aspect of it that you are concerned about. So there's no specific submission requirements. In the past, we've always referenced applicants to look at the submission requirements for a complete subdivision and to supply that information which they deem is necessary for their particular request. So you have some openings on that. In terms of the owner's responsibility for the phase one of the project, it's my understanding that there are some things that need to be done in phase one, and that the owner has been, that the code enforcement officer has been speaking with Mr. Hinman about taking care of those items. But I would also like to ask the applicant to perhaps explain a little bit how.
My only reference to those shortfalls in the project to date come from letters from abutters or general public stating that this wasn't done or this is done or that wasn't done, and my own driving by the project dealing with the loss of trees, major trees, due to existing grading and I'm not sure what killed the trees, whether it was the insufficient wells, grading wells around the roots or what, but it's pretty extensive. So once you define the scope of how much of a review this is, then it, to me, as one board member, it sort of dictates how much of the plans do we actually look at. I also think in terms of whether we decide to have a public hearing or not. I guess historically this board has always leaned toward having public hearings, especially when we hear some communication from abutters. With simply the grading plan change, that seems to be a pretty straightforward issue. There are questions about the technical merit of that, but they're pretty limited from my one point of view. But there are other issues which we have learned historically. When sites come back to us or applications come back to us for review and items are not complete or they're completed incorrectly, and I'll refer, the Tinsman site. I don't want to pick on Tom's site, but there must be others, where the request to go forward with more improvements and the original improvements weren't done correctly or were not done to the approved plan. After a rambling statement, I guess I'd just like to establish with some consensus from the board that we pursue with a public hearing. How much of a review do we feel comfortable with?
Do I have comments from the board? Because I have a substantial comment to make myself. You want to go ahead?
I guess following on Steve's comments and not having been involved in this project originally and having heard that there were problems.
I don't think any of us were.
Okay. from the original owners. I personally, and given the fact that we're looking at revised plans coming back for only staff review, I would favor seeing this again before the board. Based on the two letters we received, I would favor a public hearing of some sort. I might even see the need for a site walk. Mm. Considering these buffering issues. A quick question to the applicant. The unit that's under construction, are there regrading issues for that? Are you building that at the grade that was approved?
That is being built at our proposed new grade that's on this plan, not on the original grade, so that it would have to be raised. I think that particular unit would be 3 feet higher if we built to the design grade on the original plan.
If there were, you want to jump in? I was going to say if there was some mechanism to allow one unit or the two units to be continue construction, I don't know if I'd be opposed to that in particular. But and I'm also very sensitive to the whole performance guarantee issue, I think, wasn't that part of the problem, Maureen, on the last approval? Is, I don't know if money ran out or what, but I'd like to see some real protection for the town here.
I hate this subject.
You're not supposed to say things like that on the record. Could I, excuse me, Madam Chair, could I ask the applicant, on the 8 units that are closest to the road, are those all owned by people other than the applicant before us tonight?
I believe that's correct. They're condominiums, so that
right.
the individuals
so the
that,
8 units have
yeah,
been sold.
Yeah, they're owned by individuals who are members of a condominium association, of which Jim Hinman, as James Development, is also a member because of his ownership of essentially these 14 units. So
right.
he is, just like anyone else in the condominium association, subject to all the association rules and regulations.
Except he has more votes than
well,
anybody else
he,
at this
he has
point.
A controlling interest at this point.
Right.
That's correct.
Does he have declarant rights? Did he take up declarant rights from the original declarant?
I would have to refer to Jim on that. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, these are my thoughts on it. Technically, what we have here is a project that is completely approved, with the exception of wanting to change the grading rights. They could go out and do just exactly what's there right now. As I understand it, along with the good things that this new developer acquired with this, he also acquired the onus of completing everything as it was originally approved. He gets the good, he gets the bad, which I don't think is going to be a problem. We've had some thoughtful, well-articulated letters from some abutters whom I would give myself a 100% chance of saying they're all here. relative to some buffering issues, and which is something that I want to speak to in just another few moments. I, as well as Ms. Lardner, and I'm sure for the most part the rest of the board don't want to see this brought into a quagmire and not moving off center for the next 2 or 3 months. I understand why you want to continue the work on the unit that you've started. I'd love to see some mechanism for you to continue it. I am familiar with the developer. I have, number one, every reason to think that it will continue along just the way it should, and I have a great deal of confidence in that. However, there's a great curiosity. I would like to hear some public, some sort of public input. I would be willing to open the floor tonight to the folks who are here. I don't know if we should open it to or have a regular public hearing for everyone else that's involved. There's a part of me that keeps going back, you know, we're only changing grading rights, which is going to help this project preserve the trees and some other things. Incidentally, as a kind of an aside, we have projects, we have pet projects in town. We have a project that made us end up reviewing our road standards because we didn't like the way they came out. This project is one that's really making us look really very hard at landscaping. This was a woods, Cape Woods. They killed every tree in there with backfilling and whatnot. It's a tragic case of what you wanted to come out looking like and how just simply because you don't know or understand how easy it is to kill a tree, they look so solid that 6 or 8 inches of topsoil backed around their roots and they're dead in 2 years, just as if you'd cut them right down. So this is something that we're very sensitive to, the preservation of the trees. And I think this will become something of, the word fails me. I want to say benchmark, but that's not it. It's something else. It's Alzheimer's is getting to me, I think. But of making us look at each project far more carefully with respect to landscaping and preservation of trees and whatnot, because this really is sad. In the way, I live right near there. Could see it just dying right there. Do we have some comment from the board on whether we want to open it up to a public hearing right now? How do you feel, Steve?
I think if we open it to a public hearing, then we're opening ourselves up to having a public hearing next month as well, due to proper notice for a public hearing. I think we just open.
I'd be willing. I'd like to hear what these folks have to say.
I have no problem with that. But if we do that, then I think the board has indicated that they want a public hearing. Then we have to also have a public hearing next month after proper notification. I don't think we circumvent that. If the people are here and choose to, then that's by consensus of board. We can go ahead and do that. But I think that sort of dictates that we also go ahead with a public hearing.
Steve, how do you feel about letting these folks speak?
I think probably it would be better and more concise if we had one public hearing at the next public meeting of the planning board.
Janet?
I don't disagree, although I don't mind hearing people tonight. I guess I'd like to suggest, picking up on Judy Lardner's suggestion, that perhaps it would be appropriate to do a site walk. I mean, when I first looked at this material, I thought we were going to be doing, you know, a relatively focused investigation on particular something. But as I think more about the condominium questions involved, I suspect that I would be willing to do a site walk, in which case perhaps it would make more sense, if everybody else is agreeable to that, to simply have a site walk, have the public hearing next time, and then go forward.
Is that, do you go along with that?
Sounds good to me. I also would have no objection if the board wanted to hear comments, although I'd like to say that the letters we got, I thought, were the clearest letters we've had from abutters in a long time.
I almost think you don't have to present your case. They were non-argumentative and very, very good. Have you seen the letters from the abutters and what it, relative to the buffering?
Yes, we've seen copies that were included in the packet of material that we got from.
Do you understand? And of course, we haven't been there, so we're just trying to, you know, visualize it from on paper. What their issues are, and how do you intend to deal with it, or do you have any thoughts on how you're going to deal with it?
Well, I haven't looked at it in great detail. I have been out on the site and looked at it in some sense with Jim the other day. I guess the two letters came from the abutter here, Barbara Lisford, and I believe it's Paul Cusick.
No, other way around.
Other way around. Sorry about that. The plan just says Liscord. This area here is going to be interspersed with some hemlock plantings, you know, that will be in amongst a mixed forest right now, which has some large mature deciduous, as well as there are some evergreens in here in the understory. The distance from the unit that's closest to this dwelling here is about 150 feet. And it is all wooded all the way across here. My sense is that you're never going to block the view entirely, but this is certainly going to help to filter that view so that there shouldn't be that much, you know, of an obstruction. It should look relatively well screened. The other letter was from Judith Sider, who's, I believe, dwelling is here, which has been expanded since this plan was drawn, and it includes now an addition in the back of the deck here. This is over 250 feet from the nearest unit, number 15, and the property. The topography drops through a swale behind, and then it rises up. There's a knoll right here before you get to the unit, and we're proposing to put all the plantings on the top of that knoll. You know, standing there with Jim the other day, it seemed to me that, you know, this is a pretty dense proposed planting that, you know, here again, with the existing, you know, mature forest with the understory and these additional supplemental plantings, there's going to be some views, but they're going to be pretty well screened, in my opinion. I don't know what else you can do other than to build a fence or something that's completely, opaque to prevent seeing anything. One thing that I will point out is this particular unit has no windows on the second floor, so that they're basically going to be looking across the ridge at a gable end, and that's about it. There's no way we can completely hide our project, and I guess, you know, what we feel is that as it's planned, it's going to do an adequate job.
Now, what's happened apparently was that the area for the sewer easement was cleared. Is that right?
What was that again, please?
The area of the sewer easement?
Yeah, this is...
Or utility easement, is that what...
This is the sewer easement right here. It was cleared, and, you know, it's starting to grow back naturally. I guess, I don't know if there's ever been any discussion with the sewer district, but my hunch is that they wouldn't be too pleased.
No, they wouldn't. They wouldn't allow you to do any planting on that.
But, I mean, as a natural, you know, occurrence, there are, you know, small trees starting up. I mean, they'll either have to go in there and clear that themselves, or that is going to eventually turn back to wood.
But none of the proposed bufferings were planted, is that right?
These haven't been planted yet, no.
No, and the ones on the knoll weren't planted, haven't been planted.
Not yet, no.
So, yeah, that's sort of like this.
Do you want to say something?
Yeah.
Would you please come to the to the podium? It's just because no one can hear you on TV.
I'm not going to stay here long, so don't care, okay? There's approximately 30 trees here, approximately 30 here. The people that live in this area of the development came to me when I bought it and asked me if I would please put these in the springtime. I think they were in within 2 weeks after they asked. These will go in as soon as anybody wants them. What I have been asked to build and what I saw on the plans will in fact be built. And it will be built expeditiously with competent people and quality materials. The issues that I hear being raised were not within the original granting of the subdivision. I'm hearing things outside of that. If that's what the board wants to include in my project, then fine, let me know. But I'll build what I agreed to build when I bought it, which was the plan. Glad to do it.
Does that answer the questions about at least 50% of the trees are in fact planted?
Okay. No, I think it, I envision it's more of we're not going to reinvent the wheel here.
Pardon me?
We're not going to reinvent the wheel here or reapprove it. But it's always an, as far as I'm concerned, if you have some input, you might as well hear what everybody has to say.
Oh, glad to.
And I have every confidence that you will complete the project as exactly as it was approved. I really do. I, you know that.
We've been doing it for 70 years, I think. I don't think this one's going to change too much.
Thank you.
Thank you. If there's any other questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
No.
Madam Chair.
Mr. Etzel.
To go back to my original question again, so I'm not real, it's not real clear to me. I mean, the fact that a new applicant, new declarant developer comes in, it, in essence, is no different than if Mr. Tobias were to have come back in for the same change. I mean, that's the way I understand this process, that they have the same declarant rights and, mm-hmm. and liabilities. I guess it's what Maureen is telling us is that it's up to this board, the depth of review. The applicant, and I have to take him at his word, that will, you know, he did buy the plans, and but the problem that I have is the only part of the plans that I am looking at are the final grade. Does this board want to take a review of the entire subdivision again? Are we just looking at the final grade? How many cans of worms do we want to open up? If we're talking about buffering, do the landscaping details go on the grading grading plan? Do we detail the size of trees, numbers of trees, as we typically do in a subdivision? The questions I don't have an answer for right now.
I think you bring some valid points, and I've sometimes it is hard because indeed we can change the depth of our review. As far as I'm concerned, what the applicant is proposing here is all for the good in view of what's happened there before, which are conscientious, better grading levels that will preserve the trees, which unfortunately were just decimated. Not even that, they were just clear cut practically for all intents and purposes in the first phase. I think there is a concern. You have neighbors who are concerned because they got stuck next to a failed development that's failed, and it's been failed for a number of years. The things that were supposed to have happened didn't happen. I think they have valid concerns of whether or not the things are going to occur, which were supposed to have occurred, and supposed to have occurred 5 or 6 or 7 years ago. And indeed, now they're seeing for the first time some development out there. Maybe they had this sort of a kind of a cocoon of, oh, I don't have to think about it or worry about it because it's all dead and it's nobody's ever going to build in there because the guy's gone bankrupt and the bank's got it. And well, now we're back on track. The bulldozers are out there and the backhoes are out there, and they're starting to get nervous. I think they have a valid concern of making sure that everything is there, and I think we should make sure that the applicant is perfectly clear, and I believe he is, that everything will be planted and the bufferings will occur and the project will be completed as well as we have every intention to expect. I don't see any need for a greater review. I'm still, frankly, agonizing over whether or not we should have a public hearing and sidewalk.
I guess just to bring my own discussion to some type of closure, I, as one board member, I just simply feel that at a minimum, we should schedule a site walk to be held between now and the next meeting, to hold a public hearing next meeting with proper notice, and that the board be prepared with sufficient amount of information that perhaps we can take action next month. Go into the meeting prepared well enough so that we don't drag it one more month. I think at a minimum, we owe it that amount of review.
I concur with Mr. Edsel's comments, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Judy, do you have thoughts?
Not having any experience with this developer, not doubting what he says he would like to do, I still have problems with a plan that was not done. I can't deal with the buffer issue since it wouldn't have made sense to put in the buffer before they developed that part of the property. But just what I've heard over the last couple of years, that there have been town problems with Cape Woods, and there is public comment, and I would feel very irresponsible if we tried to approve it now based on what little I've been told. Just telling me that the grading will help, changes in grading will help preserve the trees doesn't tell me much. Who says? No, Tom Emery's not even here. I'd like to rely on him. So.
Steve?
I guess I have some mixed feelings about this. Seems that their proposed changes are so slight, it does seem that they are to everyone's benefit. I'm not so sure we need to revisit this again, but if the board so wishes, then I will go along with it. I just don't think I see the need for it.
You know, there's this other side, which is, he can go in and take that foundation out and build it just the way it says on the plan, and the trees will all die, and we'll all be sitting there with, you know, I do feel, would you please come to the podium, please, if you're going to speak?
I'm trying to pick out something here to give you an idea of what 4 feet really looks like in your mind's eye. Let's take this railing right here. Okay, it's more than 4 feet, but let's say we've got to go on a 5-to-1 slope, which is what I think they call for. Is that correct, or pretty close? 4-to-1 or 5-to-1? Okay, 4-to-1. So every foot you go down, you go up 4. Okay? Here's the building. Here are the trees. I'm standing in the trees. And every house lot over there is like this. The trees are that close to the proposed foundation. All right. So if I come out 5 feet, up 5 feet and then out 20, that puts the material that's going to be graded up against the foundation approximately from that wall to my feet or more. This is the reason that we're asking for the change right here. This is the crux of what we're trying to discuss. If I eliminate that 4 feet and put the foundation down here, let me move over so you can see it. If this is the height that's proposed on the plans now, as is, and somebody drops that foundation grade to an elevation here, which I think is 1.75 feet, showing the foundation, Then you go times five. That means the tree that's this big and been there for 100 years, this far away, is going to make it. That way, it isn't going to make it. That's why you have no trees on the phase one. That's what I'm trying to eliminate. I'm trying to make that a good-looking project. Now, if we build it the way it's called for, I got no problems with that. Cost wise, it doesn't make much difference. It'll look barren, just like the first one. It's a pretty simple thing if you can look at it in those terms of grades. That's my comment.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Madam Chair, could
yes.
I? First, a question to Maureen and then a comment. Maureen, is there any way at all that this gentleman could go ahead with construction of the units he's got under construction now without us taking complete action right now?
I don't see a way that he can continue without you granting approval of at least these elevations. The only approach that I can think of, and I wouldn't want the board to use this on a regular basis, is to approve what he's asking for now, add a condition to it that you want him to come back next month to address, I don't know, buffering, whatever other issues you want to have addressed. And then at this meeting, you could schedule a public hearing for next month. I wouldn't want to look at that recommendation too closely, but in that way, he's got the approval for at least the elevations. He can drop the buildings and continue construction for a month, and then he has to put together a new set of drawings to address the concerns you've raised for next month's meeting.
I don't know how I feel about that, and I can really understand that you're trying to better this project, and I'm going to say what I said last month and I got in trouble for, but this is one of those instances I feel like the board is being held hostage, because I agree this should be done, but I really have a tough time with looking at town engineer comments saying, and I haven't checked what he said, but it looks like we have some negative drainage with drainage going toward foundations, and it could easily be draftsman errors, but saying that, you know, by God, if we want this project to be better, and I'm not saying you're saying this, this is my interpretation, that it would be best for the town if it's approved tonight, because if the town or the board doesn't approve it tonight, then we might get a lot of dead trees. And I don't think you're saying that. But what in a couple of past projects this has happened, and I'm very hesitant to go ahead and take people's word. Excuse me, I'm not talking about your word, but the town engineer's word, or somewhat without having it all brought to some sort of resolution. If the town planner can honestly say to me that these particular conditions are ones that town staff feels very comfortable handling on their own, I feel fine about that. If it's one of those instances where the board is kind of delegating a lot of authority to get this through, I don't feel comfortable. Maureen?
Could address that. I think I can say with some certainty in the past that I've identified areas where I felt conditions were very subjective and that the board may have been delegating too much to staff. I told the applicant that I felt that although it may not look good to have a two-page letter from the town engineer, in this particular case I thought it was very good because I felt that the engineer's comments were very specific and that I would not have recommended a condition that the plans be revised based on his comments unless his comments were very specific. My understanding is that the applicant chose only to revise the general plan to show the building elevations, and that they didn't take the time to take the actual cross sections, the detail sheets, and revise those as well. I feel that Fred Morin's comments require those detail sheets to be revised based on this general plan. So you would be using the same kind of principles that you can't have negative drainage flowing towards buildings, and what you're requiring is that those plans have to be revised as well based on this approval if you decide to grant it tonight.
Then if I could say something further to temper what sounded, I'm sure, very negative to you folks. I would favor probably an unusual approval of if we could word it properly, to grant approval to allow them to consider to continue with construction on those two units, and perhaps limit our approval to those two units and make sure there's some mechanism to have them come back to address the buffering issues and make sure that these remarks of the town engineer are cleared up. And one other thing I'd like to throw out for Mr. Camilla to perhaps review is I was told by a landscape architect recently, who I expected to be here this evening, and I wanted to run this by Tom, that some experts are saying now that hemlocks may not be around in 15 years because there's something that may be killing the hemlocks off. And if you could look into that, because if this is a very important concern of the abutters, I'd like to make sure that any buffer being put in will be in there for the long term. Thank you.
Ms. McKay.
I don't know what we all had for supper tonight or got up thinking about this morning, but let
me
say...
It's these little licorice things. That's the TV people's fault.
Let me say that I have never met the person who's presenting on the behalf of land use consultants before, but he looks to me like an experienced person, and I can say that in my almost 4 years on the planning board, I believe that I can say with some assurance that having something come up and be approved in the first time it comes is the exception rather than the rule. I would like to state for the record that I have absolutely heard nothing tonight that would encourage me in any way to deviate from what the standard practice is of this board. Is if we're going to have a site walk, let's have a site walk. Let's not try to have some kind of a partial, let's do something with two units and look at it later. We've always gotten in trouble before whenever we've tried to do something where we've got conditions for this, that, and the other. I'd like to say that I have absolutely no difficulty delegating to the town staff the resolution of the narrow issues that were presented. If this board determines that the only thing that it wishes to look at is the level of the floor, then and the particular issues that come up from the town engineer's letter, then I would have no difficulty in referring that to the town staff. But I, for one, am quite interested in exploring other aspects of the project just to make sure that the that there are no other questions raised on the condominium side. And that's why I would like to suggest following the standard procedure.
Do we have any further comment? Then why don't we have a motion and let's... I believe what we're going to...
I wrote a letter. I just don't want it to be misinterpreted.
Would you like to approach the and speak?
Sure.
Okay, why don't you... Do you mind, Mr. Camilla?
No, it's fine.
I'm Paul Liscord, and I live at 14 Woodcrest right here. And my wife and I submitted a letter, which you have read. We don't want to create a quagmire here at all. We're happy that the project is proceeding. We've been living with a dump in our backyard for quite a while. We like the layout of the hemlocks. That's fine. So we don't have any problem with that at all. We said in our letter we thought these were a little short, but upon our own review, they're not significantly short with respect to what the original plan called. So we apologize to the board. We apologize to the developer for that misrepresentation. The only thing we wanted addressed, which Mr. Hinman said he would be willing to plant these at any time, was we just wanted to see these hemlocks in sooner rather than later. So if you folks, from my perspective, you're going to slow down this project because of our letter with respect to hemlock screening, that's not what we were hoping for. We just wanted to say that, look, this is great. We just would like to see it in sooner rather than later, because Maureen O'Mara had said that traditionally the screening type stuff goes in last, you know, after the entire project is done. It's a small part of the project. Why not get it in sooner rather than later? But I think in terms of one of my biggest fears is to have this thing go back to nothing happening and having a sand pit again for X number of years. The work they're doing down there is good. They've cleaned up the mess that DeBias left there. So from our perspective, we certainly don't have any problem with the elevation of the foundation, but from our perspective, don't slow the project down on our behalf.
We can slow projects down.
Pardon?
We're good at that. We don't want to do it, really. Thank you, Mr. Liscord. Why don't we have Ms. Seidel speak, whom I'm sure, is that?
Cedar.
It is Cedar, and I want to put an L on the end, but
that's okay.
That's the Alzheimer's.
I'm Judith Cedar, and I live at 10 Woodcraft, which is over here. It's listed probably on your maps as the Karens, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm probably, because of the topography and because of the very large financial investment that I made in my home based on misinformation, I'm probably the one with the most concerns. I know that the owner of my next-door neighbor here, Betty Thompson, she also is very concerned, but she lives in California and didn't have the time to come here, couldn't come here. She's involved in some important work at home. So perhaps I could, I've been in contact with her on the phone, and perhaps I could speak with her and have her submit a note to you, whatever, which I think would be similar to mine. But I think what's important here is that I really appreciate that, I don't know, there you go, there you go, Mr. Hinman's efforts to give us assurances that he's going to do everything necessary to create a buffer. My concern is that there are all different kinds of buffers. And, you know, if you look in Webster's Third New International Dictionary, which I did tonight before I came, I'm going to read to you the definition of a buffer. This is the primary definition, number one. Any of various devices or pieces of material designed primarily to reduce shock due to contact. So, I thought that was wonderful, because if anybody's shocked from contact with this development, it's me. But, again, so what I think is really important, and obviously I'm coming from just me, I mean, and you might think it's a selfish point of view, and it is to a large extent. Because of the topography, my house is higher. I'm much more exposed and vulnerable to a loss in privacy. Mr. Hinman says he's going to plant hemlocks, but see, that's not good enough for me. I need to know, and I did some research on this, I need to know where the location of the hemlocks will be. I need to be told they're not going to be just scattered here and there like they have been so far. Scattering doesn't build a buffer. Scattering does not build an evergreen hedge, which when I read the subdivision ordinance, my reading of that says that it was the board's intention to have an evergreen hedge, to have a buffer. Now, if a buffer, according to the definition, means that you shouldn't have contact between the two objects that you're trying to separate from each other, then that says to me that you can't just stick in hemlocks here and there, that they have to be planted 4 feet center to center in a straight line. Right now, Mr. Hinman hasn't told me where he's planting the hemlocks. Someone on the board tonight said that she understood or heard that hemlocks are going to die in 15 years, or maybe they're going to be subjected to some disease. I'm not sure. I was also told by Skillens that dark American arborvitaes make a darn good hedge, and maybe they're not subject to whatever disease is coming for the hemlocks. The location of the hedge is of critical importance. If you tell me that you're going to put them on the knoll, that does me no good whatsoever. I need the hemlocks to be planted closer to these two units over here. I also need to, because In other words, it's like I need for them not to be able to see me, not so much that I can't see them, because I'm so high up, as I wrote in my letter, I can't put an evergreen buffer on my property. I'd need 50 plus feet high before I had any success in maintaining the privacy that I've experienced. So if my understanding is, in the research and the talking to landscape people, that the buffer needs to be placed on Hinman's property, and it needs to be placed, we have to find out, do deeper research, closer to these properties, so that the hedge, in fact, you know, is closer to their property, so that when they're looking at it, they're going to see some lovely hedge. And I'm not suggesting, and I know you're worried about this, that these folks ought to be, that they themselves should feel like they're hedged in. I don't want them to feel like that. You know, they're just like myself, they're owners now of property, and they want to be able to enjoy their property. So I don't want these hedges planted right outside their windows. I want them to be able to have access to the land around their homes, their condominiums. But it needs to be planted at a location which will successfully create a buffer as the board has always intended it to be. Planting closer to the property line will be useless. Planting in the knoll will be useless. That will not create a buffer. Planting here and there will not create a buffer. You can, when there's spaces between trees, you can see, you know, it's not a hedge, it's not a buffer. It does not prevent contact. So I worry that, I mean, it's very appealing to hear Mr. Hinman say, we want to be good neighbors and we really want to have this buffer. But my attempts to talk with him were disastrous. but I contributed to that. I will share that with you. And my fantasy was, if I was a man, it would have been like a barroom brawl. But when I talked to Mrs. Hinman, she said, everything is fine. There are going to be 34 hemlocks. Now, then I talked to Jim, because Sharon wanted me to call her back. I called her back. She wasn't home. I talked to Jim. Jim says, oh, there's absolutely no trees going to be planted there at all. And I said, well, whoa, because I hadn't seen this yet. 34, I don't know. Do each of these circles represent one tree? Well, there ain't 34 trees over there.
11.
There are 11. So, you know, my other concern then with Judith Kane, chairperson, you have stated, and I want you to hear this in the right kind of way, you've stated a couple of times tonight that you know Mr. Hinman and you really feel confident in his ability to do what
he's... I'm familiar with his business.
Okay. I don't know...
construction, that's all.
Okay. See, I don't know the extent of that.
No.
And, okay. Now, I'm just concerned about a conflict of interest, you know, that
no.
He's your friend.
No.
And you want him to be able to build and not have to sit through the winter and have his money being thrown out. So, okay, that's makes me feel
good. No, I'm familiar with his business and primarily in the business field.
Okay.
And his strength in, or
sure.
By perceived his strength in construction.
Mm-hmm.
That's all.
Yeah, but I think, I guess, also, well, I was concerned by another thing I heard tonight. This gentleman, I don't know your name, mentioned that one of the foundations was going to be raised, right? You said what?
Two.
Two, okay. But you didn't say which ones. I'd like to know which ones are going to be raised.
Two that are on the right-hand side of the road in the wet area. Michelle Pitts.
Okay, great.
17 and 18.
Yep.
Okay. Okay, now that's interesting. All right. So that's interesting because that obviously this is the one that impacts upon my house the greatest, and he did not mention to me that he needed to raise the elevation of this condominium, and he omitted to mention, he had my letter, and he did not mention tonight that this was the specific unit that was going to be elevated. You know, he just said, well, we have to elevate one of the units. And that kind of omission frightens me. You know, that's a withholding of information, and he may have been concerned that I would then see that as a red flag and say, oh, wait, wow, that's the one that affects me the most. But now I know, you know, at least I was intelligent enough to ask which one, and now I find out, so now I'm even more frightened and more anxious by that. So I think that, I don't think you can separate out the issue of foundation, elevation, and buffer. That they go together. And we know the history of this development is horrendous in terms of the devastation that it, that, you know, it succeeded in bringing upon this very beautiful wood. So I would urge you to not separate out those two issues. Just make sure I mention. And if you have any questions, feel free. And Mr. Hinman, if you want to ask me anything, feel free.
Is that all? Are we all set then?
Well, I was just going to look and make sure that that I said what I wanted to say. I think I have, and I think I've certainly given you a long letter to read. But I do think I would support tremendously a site visit. I think that you really would be too difficult for you to appreciate what the situation is like. I mean, you, Judith, you seem to have a real great knowledge of Cape Woods, so you know what's happened there. I don't know if everyone else on the board has such an intimate knowledge of what's happened to these particular woods, and also to the topography, and also to the change in the footprint of my house. And obviously, I too, as Judy Lardner, I too was not here when in 86, I moved in 88. I wasn't here when this whole project came up. So, you know, that's water under the bridge. That's gone. But it does concern me and alarm me when Mr. Hinman says that, you know, he's going to put in, I have your quote here, or put in hemlocks here and there. Hemlocks here and there will not create a buffer. So I think we have to be real careful in our definition, in following the definition of a buffer. And Mr. Hinman needs to know what that definition is and how to accomplish
it. Are you thinking still in terms of the Webster's new third or definition of the buffer?
Well, that and I didn't read that.
I was going to say, because there's really no way that you can complete. I envision a buffer as a mitigating area between type of development or work.
But
I would
hope that we would have some flexibility. Buffers are supposed to separate the vision field between two. Well, in this case,
but it can't eliminate it necessarily.
It can't, and I realize that, and I accept that. I mean, I accept I'm going to lose privacy on my second floor completely, and I accept that. What I'm here for is to ask you to help me maintain privacy on my first floor, and I can't do that on my property. I need Mr. Hinman to do that on his property. And reading the ordinance just made it clear to me that it was always the board's intention to have a buffer between a subdivision and homes that had already been established nearby.
I appreciate your comments, and thank you very much.
Your
letter was very good. Thank you. Do we have any other comments from the board? Judy Lardner?
I guess just to add one final thing for the record, if we do decide to go ahead and review this next month, I in no way intend to open this up and look at any number of new issues. If you're proposing to change the grading to save the trees and make it a much more attractive project, I would just be looking to see that that's in fact what your proposed grading will do, and I would be completely supportive of that. And I would also be, my intent would be that the buffers that were proposed to go in would in fact go in, and we would have some guarantees as to that effect. And if there were some minor modifications in the buffer necessary, I would agree with that. But I would not be looking to review a lot of new issues or make major modifications to what had been approved before.
Thank you. Steve?
Madam Chair, again, of the planner, of the original approval, was there a plan for landscaping in that package?
There is a landscaping plan. The plan you have before you is probably the most specific. There is another plan which also shows a walking path. But other than that, this pretty much is the most specific information that was approved. The one other thing you may want to be interested in is this particular plan does not include a minimum size for the hemlock plantings. However, the performance guarantee, which the town still holds, specifies plantings of 4 to 5 feet in height.
I wasn't aware that the town still holds a performance guarantee.
Yes, we still hold.
What's the amount?
There was an original guarantee, which was then reduced, and the problem the town ran into is that it was not the project was not completed in a timely manner. Mm. There's a question as to whether the amount of money that we have left would cover the remaining improvements. The amount of money, I believe, is just a little over $47,000.
How did I remember just in the last X number of months or last year or so reviewing a letter.
The letter.
How does that compare to the cost to finish?
The last letter you reviewed, there is a letter of credit that was issued by People's Heritage Bank, which is now in the amount of a little over $47,000. In, I believe, November of 1990, there was a review by the town engineer, and don't hold me to that date, but I'm pretty sure it was November of 1990, where he felt at that time that the amount of improvements that were left to be done on the site were probably in the range of $60,000. As you're aware, construction prices have varied considerably in the last couple of years because of what's going on in the economy, and we haven't had a specific estimate done of the most recent cost. It's possible that we have enough money to do what is left to be done. It's also very possible that we don't quite have enough. Most of the work involves paving the road. I believe there's some drainage work that needs to be done, and a lot of loaming and seeding and some plantings.
Has the code enforcement officer reviewed the existing infrastructure to see if it's anywhere near?
He's been working.
Town engineer.
Yeah, they've both been working with the developer
plans.
On a regular basis. And actually, the reason they were willing, let's put it this way, the subdivision ordinance allows minor field changes to be approved by the town engineer.
Mm-hmm.
But both the code enforcement officer and the town engineer felt that the grade changes that the applicant was proposing were so different and so such a change that especially the 4 foot drop, that it really needed to go back before the board, and that's why the applicant is here tonight. But yeah, they're both involved and out there looking at the site and reviewing these issues.
Has the town engineer reviewed the what appears to be increase in elevation of the cul-de-sac itself?
He's reviewed the whole plan, and my understanding is that there are some grade changes, but
it may be limited to the center of the circle. I'm not sure. But
the intent is
room
that
to spread both these
while there are grade changes, they're limited and do not change the overall drainage pattern for the site.
Well, the center of the cul-de-sac appears to be 8 feet higher. That's fairly significant.
Mr. Henwitt, would please come to the
We either have a drafting error in numbers or whatever, but there has been no change asked for by me or intended in any of the ditch lines along the whole road in the cul-de-sac area. The only thing I have asked for is reducing the grades of the first floor foundations. I have not asked to change any of these contours or anything else. There is a cause and effect which will cause some of them to in fact change. But most of the areas that are requiring changes will be within 20 to 25 feet of the homes.
I was, that's why it was a concern.
You displayed
such a concern for the landscaping around the homes and changing the elevation 2 or 3 feet, and we have a cul-de-sac that's changing 8 feet in height.
Cul-de-sac has not asked to be changed.
Well, your plan as revised is 8 feet different than the recorded plan. I think those types of changes need to be made.
A typo or something. Oh. That's not the intent.
All right.
That's clearly a mistake. That's
That was not the intent.
I also picked up those changes in contour around unit number 11, 12. I think it's difficult to tell in the swale between 10 and 11. It appears to me that four of the buildings actually are raised in elevation, 18, 17, 18, 16, and 15. Is that correct?
That's right, yeah.
So there are four buildings that are going to be raised in elevation?
Two foundations.
Right, okay. So you're referring to two foundations. I guess my own comment is that, and I mentioned all the same things last time around, is that we are reviewing this. I don't want to get into an in-depth review of the subdivision, but I also don't want to just pass over it. I don't have any other plan other than the grading plan before me. If there were original requirements of the subdivision approval in 1986 that required a certain amount of landscaping, I'd like to see what that is. I'd like to have the errors changed, if there are. I think you need to take a long, hard look at all of your contours. Some of us spend hours reading through this stuff. I don't know why, but we pick up on things like that. That's a fairly significant difference when there's 8 feet in change in elevation. Lastly, we have informally opened this up for public hearing by going ahead and having the public speak tonight. I think legally we're bound to have a public hearing next or whenever we choose to take this up again. I'd like to still have a site walk. I have never actually been physically on the back portion of this site. Don't have a clue what it looks like. I'm only familiar with the front section. That's it.
From what I gather from the board, I would appear that I were looking at a public hearing, a site walk, and I would say these would be next month. I feel much as Steve Etzel does, that I do not want to reinvent the approval on this. I don't want to. I want to keep the focus fairly narrow. I would like to see it. Out of pure curiosity, I'd like to see how this all sits out. And there's a part of me, I think, much as Judy Lardner has expressed, that I would like to be able to see if there's some vehicle by which we can let the construction continue on the one unit that's presently under construction. But if there doesn't appear to be a way to do it, then rather than feel more compromised, I would go ahead with holding it until the next meeting. Do I have some other board comment? So, Maureen, is there any way we can do that? Basically, table it and still allow. If the building were at the existing grade, it wouldn't be an issue.
Until the plan is amended, the applicant can only build what's been approved.
Okay. No? Do I have a motion? Anybody want to?
I'm working on one.
Mr. Hinman, you had one more comment, I think. Did you?
I hope to pave that thing for those fall folks. I mean, there's about 2 weeks' worth of work out there to finish that whole project, or get it 95% complete. I don't mean loam and sod, and I don't mean the bituminous curb this year, but I do mean the paving on that project, from where it's currently paved through the cul-de-sac. The drainage is in, with the exception of one piece on the back side right here. It's my intent to put it in tomorrow. There's a pipe that's going in there. $47,000, you're going to have a lot of money left over. You can finish that job for probably $25,000. Now, if you really want to stop it, wonderful. Have at it. But I'd like to go out there and finish the thing. I'd like to leave that project in a state where it has my signature on it. The trees are intact. The dead limbs are cut off. The place looks good, works well, and I can get selling stuff in there. I'm trying to build a model home. I'm not going to sell anything until that model is up. Yeah, we can build in January with frozen lumber and everything else. That's okay.
But when you look at it, you are going to agree that the foundation should be low. The town engineer said so, the consulting engineer that the town hires, the code enforcement officer. I'm about ready. Maybe the thing I should do is withdraw my motion.
You can continue to work on the roads. You can pave and you can do all the site work.
I can?
Yes.
Okay.
Why?
It all fits together.
All you can't do is do something on the foundations.
I have material that has to go in between the houses to meet the grades and so forth and so on. There's a lot depending on this little decision. And there's plenty of money there. What has been asked for as far as the buffers is, in fact, going to be built. If you want me to change the buffers, throw something at me. Let me know what you think. But, we're talking to put those 30 trees in on the upper entrance. My son and I put them in 2 days, and it cost me $50 a piece. I mean, we're talking a $3,000 item here. It's nothing. And they will be in, if you want them in by the 15th of April or May next year, they'll be in. I put them in this year, but I don't think the timing right now is appropriate.
Okay, thank you. We as a board, as usual, find ourselves, perhaps we are decided, in the horns of a dilemma. And in which case, if there's no further discussion and nothing will come out of it, as is my usual way of dealing with these things, is let's vote with our hands. Good, bad, or indifferent, let's let the chips fall, unless they have some
Mr. Ernst kind is working of on the motion, I think.
I have a motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of James Development for a subdivision amendment we can add in the description there when I get to the end be tabled to the regular November 1992 meeting of the planning board, at which time a public hearing should be scheduled. Just looking for the number of lots or units. Insert after subdivision amendment a 22-unit condominium subdivision located off Mitchell Road.
Right, a second? Can you read it, Mr. Edsel? Do you want me to paraphrase?
Maureen.
Do you get it?
Be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of James Development for subdivision amendments to a 22-unit condominium subdivision located off of Mitchell Road be granted, subject be tabled to the regular November 1992 Planning Board meeting, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
I would just like to recommend, Steve, that we add the request of James, or change it to the request of James Development for subdivision amendments to the previously approved Cape Woods subdivision, a 22-unit condominium development located off of Mitchell Road, be granted. Be tabled.
Okay. That's acceptable. Yeah, that's acceptable to me.
Seconded.
Typically, but site walks typically are not part of a motion. We schedule
it after. Who seconded it? Was it you, Judy?
Mm-hmm.
So you seconded it as, do you agree to the
yes.
motion
yep.
as amended and seconded? All those in favor, signify by raising your right hands. All those opposed? Passes 4-1. Mr. Hinman and Mr. Camillo, would you like to schedule a site walk?
A warm Saturday.
I really don't want to wait
But I don't want the mosquitoes either, so it's...
We can get around the black flies.
Okay. This Saturday? What's our pleasure, Board?
The sooner the better.
The sooner the better.
The sooner the better. This Saturday may not be good for us. What about the Saturday of the 1st or October 8th? That's Halloween. Yeah, so it's the 31st.
It's a Sunday. Halloween's. What day are we on now?
20th.
That's fine with me.
Anyone can come on these.
The sidewalks are open to the public.
Children, dogs, in-laws, visiting folks.
Refresh now.
But only one person gets to speak at a time, right?
Yeah.
What time on Saturday, the 31st?
I wouldn't be able to attend probably before 10, but if the board wants to go ahead and do it, that's
sleeping
fine.
In again, huh?
No.
How about 10?
10 o'clock?
The 10s have it.
10 o'clock on Saturday the 31st. We will meet at the end of the paved, unless it's already paved by then. We'll meet wherever the road ends.
That's 700 feet long. I'm sure we'll see one another.
Yeah, we'll find each other
right
in there.
Cul-de-sac.
Great.
The road.
Okay.
Okay. No.
No.
Bring an umbrella.
This is rain or shine.
We always trust.
We're a weatherproof group.
You can.
I wear my glasses.
The rest of us.
All right.
Hemlock.
Thank you,
Mr. Henman. You're required to come as your favorite hemlock.
I will bring something. Thank you.
Order of business tonight is under new business. No, I'm sorry, it's other business. It's new to you. It's old to us. Road standards.
Okay, Curly. We're doing our free student zero. Right now.
Road standards under other business. Draft amendments to the subdivision and zoning ordinances. For any of you who have talked to any of the planning board people over the last 2 years and have asked us what we've been doing, we've been working on our road standards. It's been kind of a pat answer for me. We've got this project, that project, and road standards. A couple of years ago, there came before the board a rather ordinary request to change the classification of probably 5 or 6 roads in the town. And depending upon what classification a road is, it gets certain setbacks or plowed, or there are a whole bunch of different things that apply to different types of roads. When we looked at the road standards and decided that we just weren't going to pass it through just because it was there, and started looking at what was a road and what kind of roads did we want in Cape Elizabeth, what kind of roads did we like vis-a-vis what roads, what our standards and our ordinances said we had to build. And we have as a result spent just about, I'm almost sure, it must be 22 or 23 months.
Am I right?
It's either was January or November of 2 years ago.
The first, when you were first asked to consider the classifications, it was, I think, November of 1990.
November of 1990.
1990 was the
moment. So, 23 months. We've been wrangling with this. It started off as what we thought would be just a few months' worth of work. It became much more than that. We became very tired of it, but persevered through it. And as a result, have a first draft before us to present to the town to hear about. We're going to work on this a little bit more, and then we'll be eventually presented to the town council for adoption. I'm not really quite sure. This is the first time we've ever looked at these and not being in a workshop, so it's... Maureen, why don't you take over and kind of help me through this? I'm not sure if I should read these for everyone, or they'll all go to sleep.
Heavens, no.
I'll go to sleep.
Don't read through them.
I can do it by heart, I think.
What you have before you is the first attempt at taking the work you've been doing and putting it into ordinance language and into a draft, changes to the subdivision ordinance and to the zoning ordinance. If you want, I can just go through page by page into some of the changes that are being proposed, and you can just stop me when you see something you want to focus on. Is that a reasonable approach? Okay.
That's
starting
good.
on under 61.4 definitions, the definitions the board worked on for arterial, collector, feeder, local, and rural connector streets have been incorporated as new definitions in the subdivision ordinance. Are there any questions about those?
I guess two comments. One, while arterial, collector, and feeder makes sense in the definitions, I think if we just write local without street following that or all of those, it won't be clear, just because the subdivision definitions include anything in that ordinance. Mm. So at a minimum, we should have local street and with the proposed definition. And first, before I have a lot of comments, and I'd like to say that this looks great, and the only reason I think I can have so many comments is because it is so well done and clearly presented. So Maureen, thank you, and this is not criticism of you or necessarily of us either.
None taken.
But perhaps we should add a definition for esplanade also, since we are starting to require, or proposing to require them. I'm not sure exactly what that definition would be.
And you also want to add the word street after local and the word street after rural connector?
No.
Just local. Okay. Anyone ready to start with the next section then?
Maureen, let me, I haven't been bashful about my 2 cents worth tonight, I guess. I'm cognizant of the time and the fact that although we have certainly exceeded it many times before, traditionally we try to do stuff between 7 o'clock and 9 o'clock. I have a number of what I would really consider to be minor sort of tune-up changes on this thing, and in a way I hate to use public forum type time for it. I mean, I'm happy to keep going if that's what you want to do, but I guess I'd like to suggest that perhaps we could do this one more time in workshop and really get something that just works beautifully and then go ahead and ship it out. But I'm open to suggestion.
Well, why don't we limit it to... if your comments are, you know, I want to say punctuation or spelling or that sort of, you always catch those misplaced modifiers too, Janet. Yeah, so
that's what you paid me for.
I know. You're fine. Are they substantive in thought? We can keep the substantive things on tonight and then maybe just fine tune some of the. Go ahead,
the
Steve.
Noise came out of my throat, and I didn't even know what happened.
It's because you always speak after Janet.
I know, I'm sorry.
You always...
I talked to you. Subconsciously came out. I really don't have anything to say. No, yeah, I do. I think we should just use this evening's discussion for substantive things. I think our plan is to go back to one last sweep at workshop, mm-hmm. have a public hearing, and proceed.
Then let me say on the substantive part, the only thing I would suggest, and maybe this isn't substantive, is did we have some discussion about whether we were going to put rural connector after collector? It just seems odd to get down to local as the smallest street and then have a category after that, but have we discussed this once
it's alphabetical.
Already?
Yes. It's alphabetical, and these fit in with all the rest of the definitions in section 16.1.4.
Thank you very much.
And esplanade will be in the middle of them.
It's easier that way for people to find all those woods.
Very clever.
We might also add buffer in hand here. Carry on.
I agree with that, actually.
If we can move on to section 16.3.2, probably a substantive review would be a brand new paragraph, which is supposed to state the purpose of the subdivision street standards. And I hadn't gotten a lot of guidance specifically from the board, so I have drafted something here that I was trying to glean what the actual purpose of these standards are. Basically to, one, assure that the construction of streets that do not create safety hazards, two, to minimize the cost of municipal maintenance and construction, and three, to require streets to be consistent with the town's rural character. And I think the third one is probably the one that the board has worked most on in this most recent set of revisions. But I think purpose statements are very important. They cannot be worked on too much, and they always help to guide people into what the intent is, as well as the specifics of an ordinance requirement. So if there are things that the board would like to say in a different way.
I thought you did a lovely job in the first cut at this. What I was curious about was that we have the first three, the three aspects of the purpose stated, and then a reference to an alternative approach that picks up one of those purposes, namely rural character, and then adds another one, which is a sense of community. And what I'd like to suggest is that we move the sense of community up to make it a fourth. I'd like to say the purposes of the subdivision street standards are the first three plus the promoting a sense of community, and then have a second sentence which says the standards could be flexible where an applicant can demonstrate that an alternative approach will also meet the above stated purposes.
That sounds good. I just think the flexibility part's really good to have in there, because we just don't want that absolutely have to do it thing. Do you have... Are you getting that?
No.
Okay.
Can I just say one thing for the record? And it's
sure.
Not anything I'm proposing to change, but when we talk about rural character, which I know comes straight out of the comprehensive plan, at least one of us thinks that's not an appropriate characterization for town, but I think since we're using the comprehensive plan that the language is appropriate to continue using.
Say more.
Pardon?
I'm curious about what would you say more about what why you don't think it would be appropriate?
I don't think Cape Elizabeth is rural.
I
think we're
either.
Suburban with some very beautiful rural areas, and that one of the primary things that the comprehensive plan talks about and townspeople have in the past is preserving our rural character, and I don't think that's an accurate description of our town. But
I would certainly concur with you, and I have in the past brought that up, but it is part of our comprehensive plan. I think it makes the community of Cape Elizabeth feel good to be able to say that, and if that's all it does, that's great. You know,
it's true. It's not rural.
If you grew up in rural Maine, you know this is not rural Maine.
I drove to Dover Foxcroft the other day. This is not rural. That's anyway. Just
is
anyway.
There another word we could use?
No, I think mixing it up. It states rural character, not that this is a rural community, and it's the character that is should be emphasized, not the ruralness.
I think there's also the perception, rather. And physically, I would agree with you that the town doesn't fit into the rural category, but there is a strong sense in the community that there is a rural character or a perception that kind of rural character exists. And it's been identified as something that's important.
And as Steve says, if it makes him happy, let him call it.
There's another comprehensive plan coming in 10 years, so.
Don't give up on us, Mom.
Here for the duration. The other changes, I don't see any changes in here that really are great substance, more just bringing things into line with some new terminology.
Maureen, at the risk of being on the borderline between substance and otherwise, the last line of page one where you say a street which may be upgraded in classification, I suppose it's possible that any street might be upgraded. Why don't we say something like a street which is either likely to or highly likely to be upgraded? Standards of the potential future classification on the next page. Just add potential.
Okay, going on to the top of page two, you're seeing that the table that is currently in use is being eliminated in favor of the table, which is page three. I've named it the Road Classification Standards Table. Certainly can be called something else, but it tends to be the meat of all the revisions that are being proposed. I don't want to really spend a lot of time pointing out that table, except to say that we had asked for centerline radius, which is not in the table yet. The site distance and the speed ranges have been revised based on previous discussions. The right of the traveled way width on a local road has been revised to 20 feet. I do want to spend just a moment pointing out subsection B, the width of a right-of-way for a cul-de-sac. This is something that I think I've asked the town engineer to take a look at this whole section and to make sure that the changes that I proposed, I haven't changed every single section, and I want to make sure that the things that are being proposed dovetail with the things that have been left behind. And I think that we're going to have to go back and visit B, and we may find out that we need it and that we're going to have to pick some numbers. Or this one may work for what you're proposing, or it may be in excessive for the new standards that you're proposing. But I just wanted to point that out. Under Section A, Street Design, most of the changes that you've been working on are under this section, under one site distance. I have added in the last sentence that an isolated interruption of minimal time duration and site distance due to obstruction, such as a single tree, should not be included in the measurement of site distance. It's my understanding that in practice that's the way it's done, although technically that's not the standard way it's supposed to be measured according to ITE and ASHTO standards. What I've done in number two, changes of direction, is there's a super elevation requirement, and in the past the board has waived that requirement for local roads. What I've done is basically exempted local and feeder roads from that requirement altogether. So they would actually approach this from not having to super elevate rather than having to super elevate and then ask for the waiver.
Just a comment. I've read that several times, and I don't understand it one bit, and I trust that the language is clearly understandable to an engineer, or should that be clarified? I can't even visualize what they're talking about. And if this is very clear for an engineer, that's fine for me.
I'm assuming it's clear. I guess I understand it based on how it's been applied in other subdivisions. If the street curves at too fast an angle, then people, you figure out how fast they're traveling, and it becomes unsafe if they're traveling at a certain speed. The curve is so sharp that they tend to slide off the road, unless the road is slanted upwards, in which case it keeps them on the road. The whole idea here, though, is that you're supposed to be traveling at a minimal speed in order to take advantage of this, and the assumption that you've been making is that on local and feeder roads, people are not going to be driving that fast.
Could you, I assume that all this is going to go to any number of town staff to review. If you could have the town engineer specifically bring that to his attention and make sure that that's written in appropriate language to accomplish what we want to do.
Mm-hmm.
Maureen, with respect to the ASHTO 1984 edition or the latest edition available, are you saying that if it's okay under the 84 or okay under the 92, either one will do? It seems to me we ought to have it established under the latest or under the current edition.
I would think that's the way you would want it. That's not my wording. That's existing, but I can change it to say or most recent revision.
Mm-hmm.
Under number three, traveled way. Again, in the Highland subdivision, there was a request by the applicant to shift the road off center in the right of way, and the town manager forwarded it to the planning board, and you approved that as part of your approval for the whole subdivision. So it just seems that allowing this is just following with regular practice. The requirement on minimum shoulder width has now been referred to the road classification table.
Maureen, could
yes.
you go back on three, traveled way? Every traveled way shall maintain a constant width and shall center in its right of way?
Shall be centered.
Shall
be centered. Typos.
Judith, do you have more to say on that?
You have something else?
I do, and now that Tom's here, he would be a perfect person to address this. On Rosewood in particular, I know that was a private road. There was some talk of seeing if they could adjust around trees. Tom, I don't know if you even know what we're talking about right now. Well, right now we're talking about the road standards ordinance revisions.
Yeah, I apologize for being late. I was on the meeting this evening.
Well, we're...
What is the issue?
We're looking at page 2 of the proposed revisions under street design number 3, traveled way. I was just interested if you think there's an argument for allowing some amount of adjustment in the field to get around ledge or trees, or should any road that comes before us have all that decided before they seek final approval?
Generally, when survey information is requested, there's a trees over a certain size are shown on the survey plan and can be easily located on a layout plan for a roadway. So specimen trees or important trees during final design shouldn't be an issue. They may be in preliminary design, and there may be adjustments to the design after a site walk, for example. Knowing in many cases what we receive for roadway design is often on very small subdivisions, minor subdivisions, and there's not a lot of money initially available for expenditures, what may happen often happens is that the all of the geotechnical work going in and doing test pits every so often to determine the depth of bedrock may be an expense that's either not incurred originally by the owner or is deferred until construction. And in that case, that situation wouldn't be known until you really got well into either the design or the construction phase. I can't think of a lot of examples where one would want to be making those adjustments late in the construction process, because there are really two issues. If there are important things on the site, like rock outcrops, and presumably you're talking about ledge outcrops that are visible above the surface, that have some distinct character, and presumably large trees or unique trees that should be preserved. Those things are reasonably able to be identified during or prior to the design process and then checked during subsequent reviews of the design. Okay. So I don't, except for really mitigating, extreme situations where there's something that just hasn't been anticipated or there's some other reason, I really don't think that should be something that we want to build into the ordinance as sort of the standard operating procedure for design work. You know, as an example, a way in which if you had a 100-acre site, you wouldn't, in the initial phase, go in and survey the entire 100-acre site and locate every significant tree on the site. You'd walk the site and get a general idea for the lay of the land and do a preliminary routing of the road. if there were a time constraint, what would happen is a designer or a developer would take his best shot at it and quickly put together a set of drawings that would meet the requirements of a planning board. And it may not be the best plan, and it may not be the worst plan, but it's one that meets certain requirements at the time in which it's submitted. And admittedly, a lot of that type of design approach occurred during the 80s. I don't know if that directly answers your question. Mm-hmm. I've been listening to debates lately, and I have trouble answering questions directly.
You on that?
If we can move past the road classification standards table.